All right, 1 Kings chapter 11. As we have been studying through Scripture, we have noticed that Scripture contains both what we might refer to as heroes of the faith, but also those who we might consider to be villains, or those we might consider to be wicked. In neither case does it cover up the reality of the wickedness, nor does it cover up the warts of the heroes. And so we have the man Solomon. God gave Solomon unusual wisdom, gave him incredible wealth, gave him great opportunities. And while he was a wise king, and the kingdom under Solomon was the greatest it had ever been, Solomon did not seem to act on his wisdom the way that we might have thought he would. In fact, Solomon in his older years turned from the Lord. He made foolish decisions that didn't end well. Proverbs 19 reads, "A man's own folly ruins his life, yet his heart rages against the Lord." Solomon wrote those words. Perhaps he truly believed them, but if he did, it is certainly sad that he didn't heed what he himself had written. It isn't difficult to trace the steps of Solomon's downward spiral or downward path. Solomon began his career as king on the highest possible plane or the highest possible terms, and God rewarded him accordingly. But then Solomon began to compromise on what he knew to be true, and he began to decline. The Torah in Deuteronomy 17 places three moral restrictions on any king of Israel. First, he was not to have more horses than what was needed for national defense, lest he send his fellow countrymen, the Jews, back to Egypt, which was at that time the source for nice horses. Now, Solomon not only went above and beyond Israel's need, he brought in horses from Egypt, and he kept many for himself, and he traded horses with other pagan nations. He also was not to have many wives. The Bible says, lest his heart turn away from the Lord. Solomon, as we read last week, had 700 wives and 300 concubines, which came from nations that the Lord had forbid Israel from intermarriage with. And he was not to heap up silver and gold for himself. And as we've seen, Solomon piled up for himself great riches. When Israel first demanded a king back in 1 Samuel 8, God's prophet Samuel warned them that a king would begin to act like the kings of the pagan nations. And we saw that happen with Saul and his pridefulness. We saw that happen with David and his passions. And now Solomon kind of took it into overdrive. And as we've studied the previous chapters with Solomon, we knew this was coming. It's been hinted at quite a bit. And now, with this chapter, we have a definitive and sharp turn toward the Bible criticizing Solomon. Now, Solomon's betrayal of God called for judgment, and the kingdom would be divided. We'll see that at the end of Solomon's reign, foreign and domestic enemies arise, and Solomon becomes the desolate man that we see in much of Ecclesiastes. He futilely attempts to overturn the will of God by making attempts on the life of Jeroboam, and then finally with the end of chapter 11, we see the death of Solomon. This is one of the longer chapters. I want to make sure we keep our midweek studies feasible for everyone, so let's just cut the introduction down and let's just dive straight on in. But first, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this evening. We thank you for everyone here. Lord, we thank you for your love and your grace and your mercy, and Lord, we thank you that you know each one of us by name and have caused us to walk with you. Lord, we open up your word, desiring to hear from you this evening. Not man's word or wisdom. We want to hear your words. We want your wisdom. And we ask that you would soften our hearts that we might receive from you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. 1 Kings chapter 11, starting verse 1, says, "But King Solomon loved many foreign women, as well as the daughter of Pharaoh, women of the Moabites, Ammonites, Edomites, Sidonians, and Hittites, from the nations of whom the Lord had said to the children of Israel, 'You shall not intermarry with them,' nor they with you. Surely they will turn your hearts after their gods. Solomon clung to these in love. And he had 700 wives, princesses, and 300 concubines, and his wives turned away his heart. For it was so, when Solomon was old, that his wives turned his heart after other gods, and his heart was not loyal to the Lord his God, as was the heart of his father David. For Solomon went after Ashtoreth, the goddess of the Sidonians, and after Milcom, the abomination of the Ammonites. Solomon did evil in the sight of the Lord and did not fully follow the Lord as did his father David. Then Solomon built a high place for Chemosh, the abomination of Moab, on the hill that is east of Jerusalem, and for Molech, the abomination of the people of Ammon. And he did likewise for all his foreign wives who burnt incense and sacrificed to their gods. As well as in verse 1 could also be in addition to. Solomon's first wife was the daughter of Pharaoh of Egypt. But his first wife was also his first foreign wife, which, given what God's instructions were for Israel's kings, was not an auspicious start. There's a Jewish fable found in the Talmud that says that when Solomon married the Egyptian princess, Angel Gabriel drove a rod into the sea. A landmass then collected around it, and eventually the city of Rome, seat of the empire that destroyed the Second Temple, was built on it. The point of that fable is not that it's true, but that it symbolizes a moral decline that set in with the marriage, which eventually led to catastrophe. As we know, Solomon's betrayal of God did lead to judgment for the nation. Now, going back to Egypt may have been Solomon's first step in turning away from the Lord. In fact, look at verse 2, which implies a slide. One violation leading to another. The Egyptian princess was the first in a long succession of foreign wives, but not only of additional violations as far as taking foreign wives, but also as far as violation of other commandments of God for Israel's kings. He secured a bride from Egypt. He began to purchase horses and chariots from Egypt. The first compromise makes the next one come much more easily. And both of these actions revealed Solomon's unbelief. Solomon married the Egyptian princess in order to establish a peace treaty with her father. Peace was God's promise to David and Solomon in the first place. God would have done this without Solomon trying to fulfill God's promise for him. It revealed a lack of faith in Solomon. But the horses also. Solomon wanted horses and chariots because he didn't really believe that the Lord could protect the land. David was a man after God's own heart. But because he was a perfect man, not because he was a perfect man, but because he believed God. And when David failed in this respect, he repented. In fact, David wrote in Psalm 20, "Some trust in chariots and some in horses, but we will remember the name of the Lord our God." It's too bad that Solomon did not follow in his father's heart. Solomon's disbelief in God's ability to do as he promised led him to disobedience to the Lord's clear commands. His marriages were in direct disobedience. His procuring of horses were in direct disobedience. His accumulation of gold and silver for himself were in direct disobedience. In his instructions to the future king of Israel, God said in Deuteronomy 17, "He shall not multiply horses for himself, nor cause the people to return to Egypt to multiply horses, for the Lord has said to you, you shall not return that way again." Additionally, God had instructed in Deuteronomy 7, "You shall make no covenant with them or show mercy to them, nor shall you make marriages with them. You shall not give your daughter to their son, nor take their daughter for your son, for they will turn your sons away from following me to serve other gods." Deuteronomy 17:17, "Neither shall he multiply wives for himself, lest his heart turn away, nor shall he greatly multiply silver and gold for himself." And the same warning is found elsewhere, Exodus 34 and Joshua 23. Warnings against the snare they will fall into, idolatry and judgment. And that is exactly what happened. And judgment did fall on them. In fact, Solomon's bad example in choosing wives from pagan nations created problems for Ezra and Nehemiah over four centuries later. The Hebrew word for Egypt is Mitzrayim. It means a place of restriction. And for the Hebrews, it was a place of slavery and bondage. Now, there's something here for us today that we should consider. In terms of biblical geography, Egypt represents the bondage of the world. The wilderness pictures the unbelief of God's people today, as like Israel, they wander and fail to lay hold of their inheritance in Christ. The promised land represents the rest that God gives to those who trust Christ, who submit to him, and go forth to conquer by faith. All believers have been delivered from the world system that is contrary to God. As Paul said in Galatians 1, that Christ gave himself for our sins, that he might deliver us from this present evil age according to the will of our God and Father. Now, Scripture exhorts all believers to cling to God's grace and not to wander aimlessly through life. We've talked about this on the last few Sundays as we've studied through the first chapter of 2 Peter, how Peter says that his divine power has given to us all things that pertain to life and godliness. No Christian believer has to trust the world for anything because we have received in Christ every blessing that we need. Jesus in his prayer of John 17 spoke of our being in the world physically, but not of the world spiritually. And Scripture further reveals to us that God meets our needs in his way, in his timing. So then we have no need to make demands of God or to try to do things on our own, in our own way to help him meet our needs. We need only abide in his graces, and in this way we can have peace. But Solomon did not believe, and he tried to bring God's promises his own way. And while Israel had peace during his reign, while Israel had peace during Solomon's reign, I should put it that way, Solomon's reign brought judgment to Israel. Now, we see the danger of marrying pagan unbelievers brought up here in verse 2, which references Deuteronomy chapter 7, verse 4. Surely they will turn away your hearts after their gods. And that's exactly what happened to Solomon. Now, we have several people groups listed here, and I feel I should make sure it is understood that this isn't a thing that's about race. Really, there is no such thing as race. It's just the human race. There are differences in appearance between people who come from different places, but that isn't even race. What this is dealing with is people who are in covenant with God not being yoked together with unbelievers. These were nations who rejected God for false gods and who did terrible things in their worship of those false gods. The Ammonites and the Moabites, they were descendants of Abraham's nephew Lot. The Ammonites worshiped the false god Molech and even sacrificed their infants on his altars. Chemosh was the chief god of the Moabites. Ashtoreth, or Astarte, was the goddess of the people of Tyre and Sidon. As the goddess of fertility, her worship included legalized prostitution. The Babylonians also worshiped this goddess. They called her Ishtar. Now, back in chapter 8, when the ark was brought into the newly built temple, Solomon then exhorted the people to have hearts that were loyal to the Lord. He said, "Let your heart, therefore, be loyal to the Lord our God, to walk in his statutes and keep his commandments as at this day." That is, undivided, totally yielded to him and him alone. At the same time, Solomon's own heart wasn't perfect with God. Now, Solomon didn't totally abandon the Lord. Chapter 9 said that three times a year he offered burnt offerings and peace offerings to the Lord. But Solomon also offered sacrifices to those false gods that his wives were worshiping. This was a direct violation of the first two commandments given at Sinai in Exodus 20. "You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make an image to worship it." The Lord Jehovah is the only God, the true and living God, and he will not be put on the same level as false gods and idols. Isaiah 46 says, For I am God, and there is no other. I am God, and there is none like me." Now, of course, Solomon, he didn't come to this quickly. He gradually descended into idolatry. He gave his ear and his heart to those who worship false gods, and over time they influenced him to idolatry. Psalm chapter 1, verse 1 says, "Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stands in the path of sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scornful." Solomon first permitted his wives to worship their own gods. Then he tolerated their idolatry and even built places for them to worship their gods. Eventually, he began to participate in pagan practices with his wife. Now, the statement in verse 2, he clung to his wives in love. That's important here. Solomon became a man with a divided and a disobedient heart. James wrote that people who are double-minded are unstable and are dangerous. And when you read the book of Ecclesiastes, you discover that when Solomon's heart began to turn from the Lord, he went through a period of cynicism and despair. He even questioned whether his life was worth living. Without a close walk with the Lord, his heart was empty. So he pursued pleasures. He became involved in commercial ventures with foreign nations, engaged in huge building programs, but he still found no enjoyment in life. At least 38 times in Ecclesiastes, Solomon wrote, "Vanity of vanities." You can see in his writing that his love for spiritual values was replaced by a love for physical pleasures, material wealth. You can see how he was double-minded, and gradually his heart turned from the Lord. Verse 9. So the Lord became angry with Solomon because his heart had turned from the Lord, God of Israel, who had appeared to him twice and had commanded him concerning this thing that he should not go after other gods, but he did not keep what the Lord had commanded. Therefore, the Lord said to Solomon, "Because you have done this and have not kept my covenant and my statutes, which I have commanded you, I will surely tear the kingdom away from you and give it to your servant. Nevertheless, I will not do it in your days, for the sake of your father David. I will tear it out of the hand of your son. However, I will not tear away the whole kingdom. I will give one tribe to your son for the sake of my covenant David, for the sake of Jerusalem, which I have chosen." Now, as king and as a very wise and rich king, Solomon was arrayed in splendor. As the last chapter told us, foreign royalty, like the Queen of Sheba, were amazed at his house, at his throne. But the Lord was not impressed with Solomon's royalty. The Lord told his prophet Samuel, remember from back in 1 Samuel 16, the Lord said to Samuel, when David was being selected out of from amongst his brothers, the Lord reminded Samuel that the Lord looks on the heart. "Do not look at his appearance or at his physical stature, because I have refused him. For the Lord does not see as man sees, but for man looks toward at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart." Young Solomon was told by his father David, "The Lord searches all hearts and understands all the intent of the thoughts." 1 Chronicles 28. And in Jeremiah 17, God testified of himself when he says, "I, the Lord, search the heart, I test the mind, even to give every man according to his ways, according to the fruit of his doings." And Solomon did, in fact, know these things to be the case, because he himself wrote in Proverbs 4, "Keep your heart with all diligence, for out of it spring the issues of life." He must have written that in his youth, because in his old age, his heart was far from the Lord. Jesus Christ even gave a similar warning to the church in Revelation 2. He said, "All the churches shall know that I am he who searches the minds and hearts, and I will give to each one of you according to your works." The Bible teaches us that we are to love God with all our heart, and we are to receive his word into our hearts. Deuteronomy 6:5, "You shall love the Lord God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength." Proverbs 7:1-3, "My son, keep my words and treasure my commands within you. Keep my commands and live. And my law is the apple of your eye. Bind them on your fingers. Write them on the tablet of your heart." God wants us to do his will from our hearts. The Bible says we are to do our service in Ephesians 6 as to the Lord, not to men, knowing that whatever good anyone does, he will receive the same from the Lord, whether he is a slave or free. If our heart is wrong toward God, our entire life will be wrong, no matter how successful we may appear to others. And when Solomon was born, he was greatly loved by the Lord. And in 2 Samuel 12, he was even given the special name Jedidiah, which means beloved of the Lord. But now we read that God was angry with Solomon because the king's heart had turned from the Lord. Solomon was turning his back on the immense blessings that God had given him. He was sinning against what he knew to be the truth. For starters, the Lord had given Solomon a father who, though he wasn't perfect, was devoted to the Lord. David was a man of prayer and had prayed for Solomon and encouraged him to do the will of God and to build the temple. Also, don't forget that two times the Lord appeared to Solomon and reminded him of the terms of the covenant that he had made with David. By no means was Solomon ignorant of these things. He had many conversations with his father about God, and he knew the commandments of Scripture because all kings were to make their own copy of Deuteronomy. And he referred to the terms of the covenant from Deuteronomy in his prayer of dedication at the temple. Now, verse 11 says the Lord spoke to Solomon, but we don't know how God did that. Perhaps it was through a prophet or perhaps some other way. However, he brought the word to Solomon. God warned him that after his death, the kingdom would be divided and his son would reign over only the tribes of Judah and Benjamin. It says one tribe. I'll say that again here in just a few verses. I'll explain that when we get to it. But the remaining 10 tribes would become the northern kingdom of Israel. Verse 11, God says that he will tear the kingdom away. And this same verb, kara, it'll again be used in a few verses by the prophet Ahijah later in this chapter when he tears Jeroboam's new robe into 12 parts. There he'll say to Jeroboam, take for yourself 10 pieces, for thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, behold, I will tear the kingdom out of the hand of Solomon and will give 10 tribes to you. This division of the kingdom wasn't going to be peaceful. It was going to be a rending, a ripping, a tearing division. And were it not for God's covenant with David and his love for Jerusalem, the city where his temple stood, he would have taken the entire kingdom away from Solomon's descendants. God promised David a dynasty that would not end. And so God kept one of David's descendants on the throne in Jerusalem until the city was taken by the Babylonians and destroyed. And of course, the ultimate fulfillment of that covenant promise is in Jesus Christ. God's covenant was with David, so he preserved David's dynasty so that we would have our Savior Jesus Christ. Such is the grace of God. Did Solomon receive this warning and repent? Well, it doesn't appear that way. Because if he had, he could have heeded the words of his own temple dedication prayer, where he said that anyone who had sinned can look toward the temple and confess his sins to the Lord and be forgiven. Verse 14. Now the Lord raised up an adversary against Solomon, Hadad the Edomite. He was a descendant of the king in Edom. For it happened when David was in Edom, and Joab, the commander of the army, had gone up to bury the slain after he had killed every male in Edom, because for 6 months Joab remained there with all Israel until he had cut down every male in Edom, that Hadad fled to go to Egypt, he and certain Edomites of his father's servants with him. Hadad was still a little child. Then they arose from Midian and came to Paran, and they took men with them from Paran and came to Egypt, to Pharaoh, king of Egypt, who gave him a house, apportioned food for him, and gave him land. And Hadad found great favor in the sight of Pharaoh, so that he gave him as wife the sister of his own wife, that is, the sister of Queen Tophanes. Then the sister of Tophanes bore him Genubath, his son, whom Tophanes weaned in Pharaoh's house, and Genubath was in Pharaoh's household among the sons of Pharaoh. So when Hadad heard in Egypt that David rested with his fathers and that Joab, the commander of the army, was dead, Hadad said to Pharaoh, let me depart that I may go to my own country. Then Pharaoh said to him, but what have you lacked with me that suddenly you seek to go to your own country? So he answered, "Nothing, but do let me go anyway." Solomon's many marriages had been his guarantees of peace with neighboring rulers. And Solomon's reign had been a peaceful one. But now this system that he was using was starting to fall apart. The Lord raised up adversaries against Solomon. Several of Solomon's opponents are mentioned specifically here. First, we have Hadad, the Edomite. Among all his wives, some were from Edom, but this didn't keep Hadad from causing problems for Solomon and for Israel. Now, you might remember that David and Joab had won a great victory over Edom. The history in 2 Samuel 8 and 1 Chronicles 18 reveal that they had wiped out the male population. But Hadad, who was one of the princes, had fled with some of his father's leaders and taken refuge with Pharaoh in Egypt. Now, what had happened with Solomon's treaty with the Pharaoh, whose daughter was his first wife, we don't know. Perhaps this was a new Pharaoh who didn't recognize that treaty. And he not only gave Hadad food, shelter, and safety, but he also gave him his own sister-in-law as his wife, and Hadad had a son by her. This meant that Egypt and Edom were in league together now against Israel. And with the death of David and Joab, Hadad felt safe to return to Edom, where he planned out attacks against Israel. Now, Hadad wasn't strong enough to take over Solomon's whole kingdom, but the Lord used him to cause plenty of trouble. Solomon should have remembered that the Lord's words and realized that God was disciplining him with this. And he could have repented and he could have gone back to obedience, but he chose not to. Verse 23. And God raised up another adversary against him, Rezon, the son of Eliada, who had fled from his lord Hadadezer, king of Zobah. So he gathered men to him and became captain over a band of raiders when David killed those of Zobah. And they went to Damascus and dwelt there and reigned in Damascus. He was an adversary of Israel all the days of Solomon, besides the trouble that Hadad caused, and he abhorred Israel and reigned over Syria. So another opponent was Rezon of Damascus, son of Eliada. 2 Samuel 8 records David's defeat of the Syrians at Zobah. When David defeated them, a young man named Rezon fled to Damascus with his band of soldiers and set himself up there as king. Now, David apparently recognized him as king, and Rezon must have been a capable man because the power of Syria increased under his leadership. But Rezon, he allied himself with Hadad, leader of Edom, and he began to harass Solomon from the north. So Rezon and his dynasty of strong rulers in this area known as Aram, they would continue to cause problems for the kings of Judah even into the time of Isaiah the prophet. Verse 26. Then Solomon's servant Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, an Ephraimite from Zeredah, whose mother's name was Zeruah, a widow, also rebelled against the king. And this is what caused him to rebel against the king. Solomon had built the Milo and repaired the damages to the city of David, his father. The man Jeroboam was a mighty man of valor, and Solomon, seeing that the young man was industrious, made him the officer over all the labor force of the house of Joseph. Now it happened at the time when Jeroboam went out of Jerusalem that the prophet Ahijah the Shilonite, met him on the way, and he had clothed himself with a new garment, and the two were alone in the field. Then Ahijah took hold of the new garment that was on him and tore it into 12 pieces, and he said to Jeroboam, "Take for yourself 10 pieces, for thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, behold, I will tear the kingdom out of the hand of Solomon and will give 10 tribes to you. But he shall have one tribe for the sake of my servant David and for the sake of Jerusalem, the city which I have chosen out of all the tribes of Israel. Because they have forsaken me and worshipped Ashtoreth, the goddess of the Sidonians, Chemosh, the god of the Moabites, and Milcom, the god of the people of Ammon, and have not walked in my ways to do what is right in my eyes and keep my statutes and my judgments, as did his father David." However, I will not take the whole kingdom out of his hand, because I have made him ruler all the days of his life for the sake of my servant David, whom I chose because he kept my commandments and my statute. But I will take the kingdom out of his son's hand and give it to you, 10 tribes. And to his son I will give 1 tribe, that my servant David may always have a lamp before me in Jerusalem, the city which I have chosen for myself and put my name there. All right, so Hadad is attacking Solomon from the south, Rezon attacking from the north. Jeroboam was one of Solomon's own leaders, and he threatens a king from within. Now, Jeroboam had great management ability, and Solomon had put him in charge of the Jewish labor force from the house of Joseph. That would be the tribes of Ephraim and Manasseh. And Jeroboam himself was of the tribe of Ephraim. But by this time, all of Solomon's building projects and the manner of his conscripting workers and requiring taxes, these things had taken a toll on the people. And they were frustrated by and they were weary of the passions of this king. Young Jeroboam knew of the feelings of the people toward the king, and with this knowledge, plus the fact that Solomon had put him over northern tribes, he would eventually be able to establish the 10 northern tribes in their own kingdom. Now, at verse 29, we see that one day when Jeroboam was working, this prophet from Shiloh, Ahijah, came to him with a message from God. Unlike during the time of the judges, during Saul's reign and during David's reign, when Solomon was on the throne, prophets didn't play a prominent role. But now, prophets would again become prominent until the end of the kingdom of Judah. Usually, prophets took a messenger role from God rather than a future-telling role. Of course, sometimes that messenger role included warning of a future event should there be no repentance for what is being done currently. Perhaps Jeroboam thought it was going to be a special day. Perhaps the prophet planned ahead of time to dress up for this. We don't know, but there was this brand new robe between the two of them, and the prophet took that garment, which would have been an outer robe that would have gone over the other clothes that they would have been wearing. And that prophet tore it into 12 parts, kind of illustrate what he was saying, what he was prophesying. And he gave back, or he gave to Jeroboam, 10 of them. This was his way of communicating God's message that Jeroboam would become king of the 10 northern tribes of Israel. Ahijah explained that Israel and Solomon would be punished because they had rebelled against the Lord. Solomon had introduced idolatry into the land. Israel had gone along with it and participated, and as a result, Israel would be divided. But it seems as if Ahijah has a math problem here, because he tears his robe into 12 pieces, but then says Jeroboam would get 10, and in verse 36, David's posterity would receive 1. So what's the deal here? That's 11. It should be 12, right? Well, Solomon's son, Rehoboam, was already of the royal tribe of Judah. So that's assumed here. There would be another tribe reserved for David's posterity, a total of 2 tribes reserved for his house, Judah and Benjamin. Now, even though Solomon hadn't kept the terms of the covenant that God made with his father, God was going to be faithful in his word to David. Verse 37. So I will take you, and you shall reign over all your heart desires. You shall be king over Israel. Then it shall be, if you heed all that I command you, walk in my ways and do what is right in my sight, keep my statutes and my commandments, as my servant David did, then I will be with you and build for you an enduring house as I built for David, and will give Israel to you. And I will afflict the descendants of David because of this, but not forever. Solomon therefore sought to kill Jeroboam, but Jeroboam arose and fled to Egypt, to Shishak, king of Egypt, and was in Egypt until the death of Solomon. Now the rest of the acts of Solomon, all that he did, and his wisdom, are they not written in the book of the Acts of Solomon? And the period that Solomon reigned in Jerusalem over all Israel was 40 years. Then Solomon rested with his fathers, and was buried in the city of David, his father. Rehoboam, his son, reigned in his place. So Ahijah closed with a warning for Jeroboam. What happened to him was wholly of God's grace. So he had better take his calling seriously, and he had better obey the word of the Lord. If he did not, God would discipline him, just as he had to discipline Solomon. God would give Jeroboam an enduring dynasty if he obeyed the law of God. However, that dynasty would not replace the dynasty of David and Judah, for from David's dynasty the Messiah would come and fulfill the covenant promises. God humbled David's successors by giving them only two tribes, but he wouldn't humble them forever. There would be a future healing of the division at the coming of the Messiah. Then the king would reign over the whole nation. Now, verse 40 tells us that Solomon found out about Ahijah's message to Jeroboam. We don't know how he found out, but it's likely that Jeroboam told some of his friends, some of his associates, who were probably already upset at the way that the king was treating the people. And they opened their mouths to others and told them. And so Solomon found out. Whatever the case, instead of falling on his face in repentance, Solomon found out and he sought to kill Jeroboam. Jeroboam fled to safety in Egypt. The new pharaoh was Shishak, or in Egypt it was Shishak. He was a man who had no obligations to the house of David. He would be used by God to provide safety for Jeroboam for a while, and then later used by God to invade and punish Rehoboam, though God did prevent Jerusalem from being taken. Now, Solomon reigned from 971 to 931 BC, but the question we all probably have is, did Solomon return to the Lord before he died? Much of Solomon's life was recorded in Scripture, but we don't have everything. His admonition in Ecclesiastes 12, 13 through 14 would seem to indicate at some point repentance and restoration. It reads, "Let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. Fear God and keep his commandments, for this is man's all. For God will bring every work into judgment, including every secret thing, whether good or evil." Like Saul, Solomon had great opportunities, but Solomon did not make the most of them. He had a great deal of wisdom, but he didn't seem to have personally availed himself of that wisdom. Like his father David, Solomon sinned. He didn't have David's sincere heart and broken spirit of repentance. His works were amazing. The temple, the royal palace, the treaties with other nations, the great economy of the nation, the book of Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, the Song of Solomon. But he also introduced compromise and led the nation in idolatry and bondage, and his abuse of power eventually brought about rebellion and division. Even worse, the people followed Solomon in his bad example, and the nation became idolatrous and would soon be split. But God doesn't change, and his promises don't fail. He is faithful. And through David's line, which God graciously preserved, came Jesus Christ, one greater than Solomon, who died for us, who lives for us, and one day will come back for us. That's where we're going to stop for this evening. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord Father, we thank you again for this time that we've had studying your word. Lord, we ask that your word would be fertile in our lives to do those things that you desire for it to accomplish. Help us to be devoted to you. Help us to be devoted to your word. Thank you that you love us so much. We ask that your desires would become our desires as we seek to glorify you in our lives. We pray these things in the precious name of your Son, Jesus. Amen.